right, street talking other stuff. Hey, nice to have you with us today, this day after the 4th of July. Freedom from British tyranny. That's what it's all about, right? Okay, but you know, you need to remember that Harry and Meghan, they've had a son now and they live in California and the son is born in the United States. 35 years from now, that boy can become president of the United States and the English will be back. Hey, way to play the long game, King George III. And you know, one time when I was a cop, I pulled a kid over, you know, and I stopped him. And he looked at me and said, "Don't you know who my father is?" And I looked at him and said, "Well, didn't your mother tell you?" All right, that's a police joke because I've got a really good show today. There's a gal named Patty Manning, who is a Seattle police officer for almost 30 years. Patty and I went to the police academy together. And I wanted to have her on here today for a couple of reasons, both to talk about her experience with the Seattle PD and also what she sees happening into the city that she was born and raised in, lived for the majority of her life, and gave almost 30 years of public service to. But hey, that shows what's coming up. Street talking other stuff. Mike, Maddog, Magnotti, you stick around. We will be right back.
At Wenatchee Power Sports, we proudly offer the Polaris product line. Polaris builds the highest quality side-by-side in the industry, with off-road capability that's second to none. The Polaris pre-order program allows customers to purchase the vehicle they want without having to select from limited dealer inventory. The Wenatchee Valley has year-round access to some of the best ORV trails in the Northwest. Start your adventure here at Wenatchee Power Sports.
When you call Dix Heating and Air Conditioning, you're calling on 35-plus years of experience in the Wenatchee Valley. Spending extra time in your home, you may have discovered an unwanted aroma. Stinky feet, pets, who knows what. Call Dix today about installing their Trane Clean Effects electronic air cleaner or a Rheem Halo ultraviolet air purifier. Either way, the air quality in your home will be improved. Proudly servicing all of North Central Washington, call 884-6444 today.
Okay, street talking other stuff. We're back. And like I said, I have got a really cool guest today. This is my good friend, Patty Manning. Patty, how are you, dear?
I'm fine. Hi, Mike. How are you?
Good. Now, like I said in my intro, Patty and I went to the police academy together back in December of 1986 and January, February 1987. I, of course, went to the Wenatchee Police Department and Patty went to the Seattle Police. And actually, you spent your entire police career there in Seattle, correct?
I did. Okay. Almost 30 years.
Yeah. All right. So before we get into your police career, just give us a little bit of background on yourself, where you grew up, family, life, that kind of stuff. Tell us who Patty is.
Okay. Well, I'm a woman of almost 59 years old. I was born in Seattle and I grew up in Seattle on Queen Anne Hill and went to St. Anne's and Blanchette High School. You know, I was a Seattle girl.
Oh, really?
And that was my background. And I ended up joining the department in 1986, obviously.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. Yeah.
Now, how about family? Do you still have family here there in Seattle?
Oh, yes. I'm sorry. We had a larger family, I guess 5 kids and 2 parents. And, you know, back in the 60s, a lot of families there had that many children and more.
Sure.
Different times, you know?
Right.
Yeah, it was different times.
Yeah, Queen Anne Hill's where you grew up?
Yep. Okay. Right. Queen Anne Hill is just, we used to walk downtown. We used to walk down to the Seattle Center. You know, it was obviously a lot different times than today.
Sure.
You know, we stayed out after dark till our mom screamed and told us to come home. And yeah, no, even there, we didn't really lock our doors. It was just a different time.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's my childhood the same way. You know, kick the can in the street, you know, we go into the woods, we called it. There's no woods left back in New Jersey, right?
In the woods. Yeah.
Okay, but anybody else in your family ever going to police work, or are you the only one?
No, the closest thing to law is my father, who's a lawyer, and he's 89, and he just retired.
Oh, okay. What type of law did he practice?
Civil law. He did civil law. He was a magistrate for on and off. He would fill in, but he is pretty well known in his profession around here. And even though he just retired, he still does law conferences and organizes things. He lives over on the peninsula, Port Angeles, and he does a lot of things for lawyers over there. They have a, he's organized a lot of things over there and does arbitration. He did a lot of arbitration work.
Okay. But you still live in Seattle now, right?
Oh, no. I live in Snohomish County.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay.
No, I live up near, excuse me, I'm sorry. There's a big truck coming. I live up near Marysville.
Oh, all right. Yeah. Now, how long has it been since you, you know, when did you move from Seattle to where you are now?
Oh, that was around 94, 95.
Okay. All right. After you've been with the department for, where did you live when you were still in Seattle and working for the PD?
Oh, I was about, I lived in Ballard. Yeah. Lived in Ballard and till, like I said, I moved up here. I was going to get married to a fireman and moved close to him, and that didn't work out. So since I ended up in Snow County, which is actually, I really love it up here.
Yeah. Well, my sister lives in Arlington too. It's a nice area, but.
Oh, so we live nearby.
Yeah. So you mentioned, well, that's good. Cool. Next time I visit my sister, we'll check it out. So.
Okay. Very good.
You mentioned a fireman. That's one of the reasons why God made police officers. You know that?
To marry firemen?
No, so that firefighters could have heroes.
Exactly. Although, yeah, that's so funny. He used to say he was a Seattle Fire Department person.
Right.
And we always used to joke with each other about that sort of thing. But he did say that SFD, Seattle Fire Department,
right,
stood for sleeping for dollars. Because they had a lot of downtime, yeah, had a lot of downtime between calls. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Well. All right. So, police work. How old were you? What made you to think? You know, how'd you tell us about getting into police work?
Okay. Well, I was 23. I just turned 23 when I joined the department.
Right.
And what got me into police work was this. I used to work out, karate was one of my passions.
Right.
I worked out at a club and where I worked out there and I ended up working for the sensei. I worked out there for several years and his wife was a Seattle police officer.
Oh, okay.
She used to tell me, and actually there were several police officers. Excuse me just a minute, there's a spider coming down off the tree. I had to get it out of my way. I'm sorry. But anyway, I had to get it out. It was about to come right into my face. And there were many police officers that worked out at that dojo. Right. And they used to tell me stories. And in addition, when I was growing up, my best friend next door, one of her brothers was Los Angeles Police Department officer.
Right.
Her other brother was a Washington State Patrol officer. And their cousin was, two of their cousins were Seattle police officers. And they used to tell me stories of what they did in their jobs, as did, excuse me, just, I'm going to wait for the FedEx truck to go by. Barely hear myself. Okay, very good. So they all told me their stories, and it sounded like, wow, that's really fun. It's kind of like, wow, that's like what you see on TV. They told me, of course, they told me all the good stories, you know, all the stories of more exciting things they did, as opposed to all the paperwork and reports that, right, that make up a lot of our work, right?
Nobody ever tells you that about 70-80% of police work is paperwork and boredom.
Exactly, you know, so. Exactly. But no, they told me all the good stories. So sure. I thought, wow, that sounds really fun.
Yeah.
Because back in those days, most girls and women didn't ever think, like girls didn't grow up thinking, oh, I want to be a cop.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? No girls. Pretty much not many girls grew up thinking that. And I thought, wow, I had never thought about it. And I just kind of fell into it, I guess. And so I applied. I was encouraged to apply by my sensei's wife, and I got hired.
Oh, cool. All right.
Yeah.
With Wenatchee PD, they sent us to the academy before we hit the street. That was the same way it was with a lot of people don't know that. I don't know if that's the same, but if you hired a cop back then when we got hired, I think the officer could work for a year before they went to the academy, or 9 months or something. But I think Seattle sent everybody to the academy right away, right?
They did during our time, but before that, there were, I knew officers where they had actually been a cadet and they were sent to work out on the street for it. And it just depended on what they needed. Like sometimes they were short on officers, I guess.
Sure.
So they would send these guys out as cadets working, and they worked, and then they went to the academy. Yeah. But in our time, no. And they never send, I mean, they would never send anybody out on the street without going to the academy now.
No, I would imagine. I remember I did a background check for a guy we hired from Soap Lake PD. Ended up being a good cop. He ended up moving to the feds, I think. I don't remember where, but he told me when they hired him, he didn't go to the academy for a couple of months. And he said his sergeant just said, well, go ahead out and stop anybody, but don't write any tickets yet.
Isn't that great?
Oh,
I know. It's kind of like being, I remember the first day I was out in the car by myself. It's kind of like getting your driver's license when you're 16 and you look over and there's nobody there. You're like, whoa. So I can't even imagine those guys that just went out with no training whatsoever.
I know. Some guys did. But there were, what, I think 31, 32 of us in the class. And I think about 28 of us or 27 graduated.
Yeah.
A few for one reason or another.
Yeah. No, was it that many? I thought just one didn't graduate, or maybe two. Yeah.
No, I remember a couple that, I mean, there was one gal that I know bombed out the first two tests first three tests she took. And then there was another guy that got cut later in the program.
Gary Hall.
Yeah. Where'd you go? You get out of the academy. What was your career like? You went to patrol right away, right?
Yeah, I did. Well, when I got out, I went right up to the central area. I was there for probably like about 7.5 years. Right. And that was just when... the crack boom was, the crack epidemic was starting down in Los Angeles, when all those gangbangers were starting up, the Crips, Bloods, and all that, when they were heavy down there. That's when, shortly after that first started. And they all started coming up to the Seattle area because they were getting so much heat by LAPD and the California police officers of, you know, in various areas. So they came up to Seattle, and most of the gangbangers were concentrated in the central area where I was, and in the south end.
Okay, the Rainier Valley. Where's the central area for those of us that just know?
Well, if anybody knows where, where Seattle U is, that's kind of the western, was kind of the western boundary roughly at that time. Yes, Kessler Terrace, and then east over to Lake Washington, and probably on the north, maybe like, well, Madison and a few blocks north was central area, and then south to Yesler.
Okay, so your area was getting infiltrated with gangbangers from California, you say, right?
Oh, yeah, very busy.
Right. I must have made it interesting. So.
Yeah, I remember the first time I saw a piece of crack cocaine, because we had never seen it before.
Right.
And someone did a traffic stop and got on the air and says, hey, everybody, come on over here. I got a piece of that crack cocaine they're talking about on the news. And it was just one little piece. It was pretty funny, but yeah, lot of drug dealers, heavy gangbang in there, lots of drive-by shootings. I mean, I witnessed shootings happen, like literally in front of me. Yeah, and you know, it was pretty wild. We had a wild time. It was wild down there, but we were all really young. You know, most of us were very inexperienced, because they put, most of the new officers were in the central area.
Really?
There were a few old timers that tried to keep us in check, but kind of hard, you know, with all those young folks.
Right. So did you stay in patrol your whole career? And you said it was almost 30 years, right?
Yeah. You know, I did almost my whole career. The last approximately a year or so, I was in the North Precinct Burglary Unit.
Okay. All right. How'd you like that?
I don't like paperwork, so I didn't like that as much. I mean, a lot of folks would have killed to get that job. I kind of fell into it because I was injured and ended up getting off the street. But it's like police work, a lot of paperwork,
right.
You know, putting together the cases to go to the prosecutor and doing all that stuff. I was an APHIS, I handled most of the APHIS cases. APHIS is a computer where, and you probably know this, where the officer takes fingerprints at a scene, let's say they go to a burglary or a car prowl or whatever. But in this case, we handled the burglary theft calls. So a officer goes to a burglary, they take fingerprints at the scene. Sometimes there are none to take, but you know, they take the fingerprints, they get a hit, and then we feed them into the ID section into the APHIS system. Yeah. And then if they get a hit, you know, it comes back and then you investigate, and I would investigate the case and say, oh yeah, well, and what was funny is that you would get the same person doing, you know, numerous burglaries. So I'd get all these burgs, yeah, and the same person would be the same suspect. Yeah. And so then you'd write, you know, write up the cases for the prosecutor's office so that they would decide whether to charge or not. Yeah, send those in.
I actually had, I think it was my second or third year on patrol as a rookie. I one of the first on the scene for a murder. Then a couple of years later, when I was in detectives, the jail called me up, who had the AFIS system, and said, hey, we got a hit on one of your murder suspects. So that enabled us to clear that murder up.
It's awesome.
That was interesting. All right. So where else?
That's awesome.
Yeah. What else did you do over your 30-year time?
Well, I mean, most of the time I was in patrol. So I was on the street, and that's what I like to do.
Yeah.
I had some opportunities to go other places, and I just said no, because pretty much in my mind, patrol was where it's at. I mean, you were out there on the street, you were, you know, meeting people, you were doing the cases, you were getting in the beginning. Not, my later years, these didn't happen so often because of rules promulgated by the city. But you know, your pursuits, you get in pursuits, car pursuits, foot pursuits.
Right.
You know, you do such a variety of things. You handle all types of calls. Not, you know, a lot of people think that cops just sit out there waiting for people to speed and they're like have a speed trap or something, but no, most of the time, especially in Seattle, it was very busy most of the time where I work. So, oh, and then also for my first 7.5 years were central area. And then my last 27 years or so were in the downtown precinct, in the downtown corridor, like Chinatown, Westlake Park.
Patty and I went to the academy together, stayed in touch over Facebook, and I wanted to have her on because we're going to take a quick break, but then I want to come back to talk to her about more recent events and what's going on in Seattle, the city, and with the police department. So, street talk and other stuff. Mike Mad Dog Magnotti, you stick around. We will be right back.
At DA Davidson in Wenatchee, they believe your investment success begins with a personalized plan. A plan that is the roadmap you need to navigate your way to living your best years in retirement. DA Davidson can help you create a plan so you can take the time to enjoy the finer things in life. Let the financial advisors at DA Davidson help chart your retirement future today.
Are you a take charge kind of person? Consider a career as a health unit coordinator. You'll work to keep health facilities running efficiently by coordinating medical providers, patients, and departments. The Charter College Certificate in Health Unit Coordinator program can get you up to speed on basic patient care, health records management, health and safety procedures, and medical billing. And the 10-month online program includes a computer you keep. Get started at chartercollege.edu, where we work to get you to work.
Street talking other stuff. We're back. We're talking with retired police officer Patty Manning. She and I went to the police academy together back in 1986, early 1987. She spent almost her entire 30 years in the patrol division over there. And Patty, when did you retire again?
2 years in end of September 2015.
Okay.
Right when I turned 53.
Okay. I did too.
Best thing I ever did.
No. Okay.
What's that?
That's what I did too. When I hit 53, you know, I stayed a couple of months to make it an even 20 years.
Okay.
All right. What do you see happening in Seattle with the police department? And from what we understand, officers are leaving that department. And go ahead and give us your honest opinion of what you see going on in your hometown and with the police department where you gave almost 30 years of your life.
Well, it's really sad because, the police are not supported at all. And, you know, they say there's a silent majority in Seattle. We've been talking about that for years, but they just keep voting in the same far left wing type politicians who literally hate officers, And so basically you have a lot of citizens that don't support the police. I mean, everybody's seen what's going on in the whole country, and Seattle's one of the more pointed examples of hatred of police and not being supported. and Seattle is a different place. If anybody gets a chance to come over there, an opportunity, please do. And what you'll see are literally transient camps all over the sidewalks in the business areas, the tourist areas, the neighborhoods, drug addicts galore, transients galore. Basically, if you are a person with an addiction or any sort of problem or a criminal, you come to Seattle, it's party hardy all the time. And officers literally are not allowed to remove those people from the sidewalks without permission from up above. Huh. And they even just, the talk about defunding the police, they literally defunded the unit that goes out to the transient camps. And a lot of people call them homeless camps for the homeless, but camps with transients and drug addicts. Sure. And they were the ones that would be, when they were being cleaned out or cleaned up, those camps are being cleaned up or cleaned out, they would offer the people inside services. Right. You know, hey, we have drug treatment here. We have, a place for you to stay, you know, any mental health treatment, what have you. And that unit was cut out as well. Huh. And the reasoning behind that, by everybody's heard of a certain socialist councilwoman named Kashama. She and her compadres literally do not want those camps cleaned up. So as a result, I mean, it's very chaotic in Seattle. You have like a lot of good people there being affected very badly. People who, you know, live in the houses, in residential neighborhoods, are just literally overrun with criminals. They don't allow, basically both prosecutors, the city municipal prosecutor and the King County felony prosecutor, Dan Satterberg, they literally pretty much limited circumstances where they will charge folks for crimes. And so as a result, especially for drug crimes, even possession. I mean, you saw what the state Supreme Court did. They ruled it, unless they know they possess it, the law doesn't say that. So basically they legalize drugs. Yeah,
I don't mean to interrupt you, but you said earlier that the Seattle government, people in city government, hate the police. That's a strong term.
Literally.
Okay.
Yes.
Did you experience that while you were still working? Okay.
Well, you know, over the years, you would get some folks that hated the police. Overall, up until probably, I'd say about the mid, like 2005 onward, to the early 2000s to about 2005-ish, it wasn't so bad. You know, you always have politics in the job.
Sure.
And so it wasn't as bad. You'd have people here and there in the city council and also activists out in the community. But now it's pretty much all of them. It's, I don't know if you ever follow the news over here. Do you ever hear anybody speak up in support of the police? You don't.
Not anymore, no.
No, you don't. They literally hate the police. So yeah, I mean, I didn't experience, except towards the end, the hatred that is prevalent now. Yeah. But one of the reasons I did retire is because I just couldn't stay on the department anymore. I mean,
really?
Most officers used to stay until they were into their mid-60s.
Yeah.
But because of the atmosphere, literally we weren't allowed to do our job. We were handcuffed. And boy, in the 5 years I've retired, I couldn't imagine that it could have gotten so much worse. It's so much worse. It's just unbelievable.
Yeah.
The way that basically criminals have been allowed, and transients, drug addicts have been allowed to literally take over large swaths of the city in terms of whatever they want to do, they can do. You want to pee, they just go out on the sidewalk. You want to poop, they go out on the sidewalk. You want to have sex, go out on the sidewalk. And the police will usually not be arresting them. And officers are literally afraid to do their job. So basically, it's a self-preservation tactic. But officers, and we did this towards the end, where I was on the street, you basically just answer your calls.
Right.
You don't go out and do any proactive police work, pretty much. Because if you do, and someone ends up fighting because they don't want to go to jail or whatnot, it doesn't matter what you do. You could be right in any force you use or any action you take, but you would not be supported. You'd be thrown under the bus.
Okay. And, as a civilian, I mean, Rosie and I would, a couple of times a year, go to Seattle, see a show at the Paramount or the Fifth Avenue, go out to dinner. We enjoyed it, but you know, I don't really feel comfortable doing that anymore. And I'll tell you, the last few times we were there, I am more uncomfortable walking the streets of Seattle than I have been when I've been in places overseas, like down in Mexico or India.
It's bad.
I mean, really, it's true. You know, I've never feel threatened. It's, in Seattle, I am always on my guard. Okay.
Yeah, it's really, really bad. It's very unsafe there.
Okay.
In many areas, not every area, the rich. Now, if you go to a neighborhood, say like Magnolia, which is a very wealthy neighborhood, or way over on Lake Washington, you know, those wealthy areas, of course, the transients aren't going to be camped in front of the homes. And if they were, I have a feeling that like if they were in front of a city council member's home, they would call the police.
Sure.
Much as they dislike the police, they would call the police. And, you know, it doesn't matter whether they, this is one thing folks don't realize about officers is someone can hate your guts, but if they call, we're going to go and help them.
Right. Oh yeah, it's true. You know, we do.
Go and you help them no matter what. That's what you do. That's what we are.
I used to say, you know, you may not believe in God and that's fine. And you may not like guns, but that's okay. But if somebody's breaking into your house, you're going to call somebody with a gun and you're going to pray they get there on time.
Right. Yeah, you would. Or you or they wish they had a gun. They're like, did I really not like guns? Maybe I want one now.
We're not going to go there today. But hey, Patty, I want you I want to come back and say goodbye. Thanks
awesome.
Very much. Again, we're talking with Patty Manning, retired Santa police officer. Okay, I got one last question, but I'll save it for after the break. Street talk and other stuff. Stick around. We'll be right back.
Very good.
Your search for quality patio furniture with excellent customer service is over.
Blue Lagoon is proud to offer only the finest outdoor furniture and accessories from some of the most renowned manufacturers in the industry. Our showroom showcases a large selection of in-stock furniture, fire pits, umbrellas, cushions, and outdoor accessories. Our in-house outdoor decor specialist is available to help you design and custom order the perfect furniture for your unique space.
Kids are resilient. I just love their energy. They bounce back so quickly. I love the stories they tell. I love just their charisma, their character. I love to see that subtle smile that you pull out of a kid, you know, when you start talking with them about something they really like. I just love what I do, and I can't imagine I would be as happy doing anything else.
Flooring is the foundation of decorating. It sets the tone for your home and reflects your lifestyle. At Apple Valley Floors to Go, their goal is to help you make that choice a great experience. You'll find extensive flooring options at their beautiful East Wenatchee showroom. Engineered hardwoods, laminates, vinyl planks, carpeting. Do it yourself or have their professional installation team do the work for you. Family owned and operated in East Wenatchee.
Back, street talking, other stuff. Patty, I really want to thank you. It's good to connect this way. You know, and I thank you for your service over there. But one last question before you go, okay? Being a Seattle gal, born and raised there, gave 30 years of your life almost in service to the people of Seattle, would you ever think of moving back?
Oh, absolutely not.
Huh,
it's a horrible, I'm really kind of sad about to even say this. I've been thinking a lot lately about what a great place that was to grow up. I mean, it was an awesome place to grow up. My father grew up there on Capitol Hill, he and his brother. And he's 89 years old. He went to Seattle. He and my stepmother were going on a trip and they had to go through Seattle and they saw everything going on down there. And I talked to him and he said, I feel really sad. And I mean, I feel the same way. I mean, you look at what's happened, it's just total chaos.
Right.
It's chaos, it's criminal. It's just a paradise for criminals.
Well, I'm sorry to hear it. But Patty, hey, thanks very much. You know.
Oh, it's been nice talking to you.
Yeah. We'll connect again. So hey, street talk and other stuff. Mike
awesome.
Magnotti, thanks for tuning in. Bye-bye.
I am Corey with Rose Tractor, and you're watching the NCW Life Channel.